Hey, good morning. How's it going, everyone? So I am after 32 days and more than 530 kilometers on the Camino de Santiago. Yeah, that's right. I have done around two-thirds of the road already, and this is the Camino Frances. I'm doing the Camino Frances, the French of the Camino. And today, you know, is going to be all about my experience so far from Saint-Jean until here for the first 92 days of the Camino. I'm going to touch on topics like how busy the life is on the Camino, accommodation, a bit of finances, a bit of COVID-19, of course, because it's a fresh topic that has to be, that has to go in, and a few tips and the final motivational message. Regarding the busyness or the crowdness of the Camino, as you can observe, there is no one behind me. And the same goes for the head. And this was kind of true generally for the whole Camino until the last few days, when are more and more people joined in as we are getting closer to Santiago. And it's going to be more crowded, more packed, as especially the last 100 kilometers, they say that's the most busy part of the Camino. But so far, guys, it's quite chill and quite laid back. So if you are not a big fan of people, then I would recommend to do it now, because this is quite empty compared to the time before of the COVID-19 pandemic. So if you start from Saint-Jean, you can walk 15 or 20 days and you can do it alone easily. Of course, this doesn't mean that you have to, but you know, if you like to be in your head just sorting out stuff, you can do it easily alone. Of course, you can always join into other groups or just join to people. I experienced so far, everyone is so nice and friendly. So no problem here. So this is what I was doing for the 10 first days. Like, I was walking with someone else all the time. And then I changed in the last 12 days. I was walking alone, like starting alone. And I'm meeting my group. I'm meeting my group of 8 people at the albergues at the destination town for the day. So yeah, I appreciate doing this stuff alone, so I can figure out some stuff in my head and just sort stuff out, you know, find the meaning of life or something. So regarding the accommodation for pilgrims or albergues, they call them in Spain. So far they have been not so busy, they were quite chill and relaxed, you know, and of course there are some regulations because the COVID situation in Spain, so they cannot operate 100% of their capacity. Not sure about the current limit, but sometimes it seemed about 50%. But even with this regulation in place, there had been always enough space for everyone, as I have experienced, so no problem there. Another factor of the COVID situation and the regulation for the albergues is that the kitchens are closed many times, sometimes completely. You cannot even enter sometimes, or just there are no cutleries, no equipment, so you cannot use anything, just the microwave or the washer. So until now we cooked around 4 times, or at least one of the lady from our group cooked 4 times, so it's not that many on from 32 days, you know. So we don't count much on cooking during this time until the COVID goes away completely, or we just start handling it a bit differently. And there were a time when we only 3 of us occupied one albergue, and they told us that yeah, they are open because they want to serve the public, and they opened it for us because we called them. It was very chill, you know, so generally speaking, the albergues are not full, not busy. They are quite chill, and there are always space for newcomers, as I have seen so far. Of course, I'm heading to the last 1/3 of the road, like, and this part gets busier and busier. So but safetiness, like normal safetiness, like I have my laptop with me, my phone, my wallet, and sometimes I leave them on my bed under the pillow or just on the bed, and never had any problem with that. Safety regarding the coronavirus situation, so as in Spain currently we have some regulations, some strict measurements put in place. Like, the albergues cannot operate on 100% capacity. So that's why they close, you know, that's why they close the toilets and the showers and some beds with this, you know, this yellow tape. And of course you have to wear masks every public places, social distance, etc. Oh yeah, speaking of which, coronavirus situation generally in Spain. So for more up-to-date information, please check out the channel of Stuart from Spain Speak. I will leave a link in here or in the description somewhere for his channel. Yeah, he's making up-to-date videos almost every day regarding the current situation in Spain, so that's a very good source, in English especially. Yeah, other than that, the Prime Minister came out a few days ago and promised that we won't have a nationwide lockdown again as we had it in March. So this sounds a very good news. So what can happen is that they will have a localized lockdown. So far I remember maybe 2 or 3 cities, some small towns that had it so far. So far so good. And yeah, the numbers are increasing and they try to cut them back. I'm not sure about what's going to happen, but I think I'm quite optimistic. Like so far it's okay-ish. And worst case they will lock down one city. But if you're listening to the news, you can just know what city, what town. Either you can leave fast or just go around, you know, no problem. In myself, I'm not really afraid of the virus at all, so I don't really mind if I get it. I can understand that some people are afraid, and this is not the case for everyone. And I think if you're at risk of the virus, then unfortunately this is not really for you, this tour. But otherwise I think it's okay on the way, like here guys, you won't really have any virus here, especially that there are only few people here and there. And of course the situation is changing quite rapidly, so that's why I would recommend the channel of Spain Speak, so check that out guys. So regarding the finances, I have spent around 40 euros per day average so far, if my memory serves me correctly, which usually does. This includes food and accommodation basically. And so more in details, like you can have a menu for 10, 11, 12 euros. Depends on, I would recommend to try the menu of the pilgrims, El Menú de Pellegrino. This is the cheapest stuff usually you can have, and it's a free course menu. And the nice thing is about that they like to put a jar of wine in the middle of the table. So if it's only you who is sitting next to the table, that you can have a jar of wine, you know. So it's very nice, that's the cheapest part. And of course you can always go out in bigger cities to eat in nice super restaurants, eat vegan, vegetarian, whatever diet you are on. And so the menu is around 10, 11, 12 euros, depends on. And accommodation can be from 8 until maybe 15, that's the range I've experienced so far. So on average I would say around 13 euros you can have a bed for a night in a dorm. As I mentioned, one Brazilian nice lady from our group is cooking usually when we cook. So we ate because of cooking 4 times so far as I can remember. And this is around 3 for maximum 550 euros, so that is quite cheap. So if you can cook, because of the albergue lets you to use the kitchen and they have even cutleries and plates and stuff, then that's the cheapest option of course. And then next the menu of the pilgrim, and then you can go out, have a normal menu at restaurants, and the limit is the sky. So a few words about the preparation. I really recommend to everyone to do something physical stuff before you come. Well, if you're doing regular exercise and stuff, I think that's very good stuff. I would really advise against just, you know, working in an office for half a year, doing no exercise and then just jump on the Camino. Like I've been working 6 weeks in an animal shelter before I came, 5 hours a day, 5 days a week, and it was quite physical work and a bit of hard physical work. A lot of staying on your feet stuff. And even after almost every second day I was doing some cardio or some heat, like high intensive interval training. Just running, you know, at the end I was running 8 kilometers like up 4 for like 4 kilometers up to the hill and 4 back. And I had no problem guys at all with the blisters. The physical stuff, like I had a bit of muscle ache here and there in my legs in the first 3 days, and then nothing. So I think it was quite effective, especially that when I started working at the animal shelter, I had some blisters here and there, because I was doing nothing much except sitting in an office stuff, you know, the previous half a year, which is not I would recommend to do when you do the Camino. So a bit of preparation physical wise, just walk or stand on your feet. That's the most important, to train your feet. Of course, when you have good shoes and good sock, that they also helps to avoid the blisters. I admit I have good shoes, but the socks, they are nothing special. I just bought the cheapest one from some random shop, so it's not what you can find in the accommodation for the Camino, but still good enough, I guess. So my feelings so far are telling me not to rush in the Camino, guys, and I can recommend this to everyone. I know there are some restrictions, someone has some time limit, some deadline, but I have this sensation not to rush, because it's because when you don't need to rush, you have this extra dimension. This gives you a complete freedom, like no emails, no boss, no annoying clients, no deadlines, no ringing phones, nothing, just you, the nature, the paisaje, the landscape. You can go as you want, you can start as you want, you can go as fast as you want, you can go slow as you want, you can go alone, be in your deep in your thoughts, you can go with other people, exchange knowledge and experience, and even if you go alone, you can meet them at the end of the day, sort of, at the albergues. You can have a break when you want. My personal favorite is just find a random park in some random place, random village, random city, and just lay on the ground, lay on the nice manicured grass or anything less solid than the ground, and just put my hand in the shade, the remaining of my body, for some nice 10, and just, you know, chill there for half an hour, 20 minutes as I feel like, just give some massage to my feet. And this is charging me with so much energy, like, and I get so calm and so patient, you know, guys. So it's maybe the biggest factor leading the big plus column is that you can completely disconnect from the outside world, you know, you can just turn off the news, so you won't hear or read anything that most probably would piss you off, like how the politicians are spending your money, or how the celebrities are declaring war between each other, or anything like this, you know. You can completely leave the world behind, and then you can close out all of this noise, guys. I think there's a chance that we might discover that life is not only about rushing from one point to another, or just buying the latest product or whatever, but maybe something deeper behind, huh?
If you awaken from this illusion and you understand that black implies white, self implies other, life implies death, you can feel yourself not as a stranger in the world, not as something here on probation, not as something that has arrived here by fluke, but you can begin to feel your own existence as absolutely fundamental. What you are basically, deep, deep down, far, far in, is simply the fabric and structure of existence itself.
This was close call. Oh, the police always almost catch my camera.